Good evening. My name is Ed Zahowski. I'll be filling in for the mayor this evening, who's across town at the city council meeting. This is the Thursday, July 9th, 2015, Northampton School Committee meeting. At this time, I'll ask the clerk to call the roll.
Present.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Here.
Ms. Camden?
Present.
Ms. Anderson?
Present.
Mr. Downey Meyer?
Present.
Ms. Ethel?
Here.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Ms. Karen Forsyth?
Here.
Mr. Anderson?
Present.
You have a forum.
Well, thank you very much. First on the agenda this evening is the public comment period. I don't have any names, but I don't know if there's anybody out there in the audience wishing to speak. Well, come on up to the microphone. We'll give you 3 minutes if you would state your name and where you live with your address.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. My name is Benita Jackson. I live in Florence, 38 Black Birch Trail. And it's great to see some faces and neighbors of people I know. This is my first time here, and also my first interaction with the public school system. I have a three-year-old who's at Bridge Street, and we have had a phenomenal experience at Bridge Street. Sam Willis was his teacher this year. He's in Bridge Street. He has a twin brother, and they were both at Fort Hill. I am a college professor. I teach at Smith, and Fort Hill is the daycare, the preschool for Smith. But he needs services, and we decided that Bridge Street was a great fit for him. And so, first, I just wanted to extend my appreciation for the amazing support that he got. And we were dismayed to know that Sam Willis is there part-time, and we just found out that the school isn't able to extend a full-time position for her, and she's looking for full-time work. And so I'm speaking on behalf of parents in the classroom. There might be others who come too, but I just simply wanted to say that Samantha Willis was a fantastic teacher. I believe this was her first year, and we were just blown away by her dedication and that she put so much into the work that she did, especially with a room of kids who need lots of extra help. So I just wanted to extend my appreciation, and we are just asking Barbara Black, what is it that we can do as parents just to make sure that that you know our concerns are heard and our appreciation for this particular teacher is put down, but also to see if there's anything we can do. So I simply wanted to say that, and you know, because I am new, I should have been at the budget meetings earlier. I realized that, but simply that. Having a young teacher who is so enthusiastic, who puts so much into it, seems like a really great investment, and I wanted to have that on the record. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was very nice.
Okay. Seeing no one else, we'll move on to announcements. Are there any announcements? Ms. Hannah.
I think most everyone here knows this, but I just wanted to announce that I've decided to not run again for a school committee. 2 years ago, my neighbor, who is a Ward 1 city councilor, Maureen Carney, came home, saw me in the street, and said, no one's running in our ward for school committee. You should do it. And that's how I ended up having this experience. And I've been grateful for the opportunity to meet everyone and get to participate in government in this way. There is someone approached me a couple months ago. Her name is Rebecca Busansky. I'm sorry, I said that wrong, Rebecca. I don't know if she's here. And she was very interested in running. She has children at Jackson Street, JFK, and Northampton High School, and so she's very enthusiastic, and I think she'll do a great job if she gets elected. So I just wanted to thank everyone and just make that announcement. Thank you.
Ms. Minnick.
I think that most of you know that I am Northampton School Committee's representative to the Collaborative for Educational Services. It's an educational service agency that provides high-quality services, typically special needs, but for students for low-incidence populations in our schools, but also professional development and curriculum stuff and lots of other things. That's one of the problems with the collaborative is that there are so many things that it does that it takes a little while to get to know it. And that's the reason I mention this. I theoretically am the representative to the collaborative through December, when my term here ends. But their schedule is such that they do their reorganization in September. So I have been the chair for the last, I don't know, but it's at least 15 years. So they're looking at a new chair this coming September, which means that I will just be a regular board representative for their meetings in September and November. And I wanted to offer to anyone who might be interested or think you might be interested in serving as my replacement as the representative, the board representative to the board of the collaborative. If you would like to attend a meeting with me, I would be happy to have you join me in September or November. They meet six times a year, so it's September, November, January, March, May, June.
When do they meet? I mean, do they meet like the second whatever?
It's usually on a Wednesday night, and we've moved it to the fourth Wednesday, but sometimes that's a conflict, so it gets moved around. So it's not always exactly the fourth Wednesday. I have the calendar.
And does it still vary location here?
Yes, they split their locations every other meeting. One is at the collaborative offices in Northampton, which is over by the post office downtown, and the other meeting site that we've been using is the library in South Deerfield. Is it South Deerfield? It's not in South Deerfield. It's just across the line, but you get to it right by Yankee Candle. So,
thank you for having the foresight to think about that.
Yep. So I just wanted people to think about it. So if you think you would be interested in taking my place on the board of the collaborative, please let me know if you'd like to go with me. Otherwise, I'll just be going and somebody will have to jump in January. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Other announcements? Well, I would make an announcement that I have decided to seek a third term on the school committee. I did go and take papers out, and I have turned them back into the city clerk, so I should be appearing on the ballot in November, provided that there's not a runoff in September.
Well, on that vein then, as far as an announcement, I also will be running for a third term and am excited to be doing so. And I don't quite have my papers in yet, but I have quite a few signatures, and it's been very busy the last few weeks of school, so I've been doing that. But I'll be out there doing that, and I will be on the ballot and maybe a runoff ballot. So thank you.
Any other announcements?
Anyone else?
You want everyone to announce that?
We don't have to. It's totally up to
you. The reason I announced is I received a phone call earlier this week. Someone was inquiring as to whether or not I was running, and I've been kind of quiet about it, I guess, but it was not a secret. Just didn't think to mention it at open meeting. So
until a reporter contacted me, either, that's what
right.
I was thinking.
Yeah, so there have been actually some questions whether or not I'm running for re-election, and I am running for election, I think, technically, but in my own ward. So I'm going to be seeking to take Ms. Minnick's slot, not an at-large slot.
Oh, good. Not good, good, but I mean good that you're not going to quit. Good that we have someone to
replace. Not rid of me yet. No.
Yeah. Although now we'll have a race in Ward 6. I mean, I do know that one other person, and I'm glad. I think races are very, very good. It gets an opportunity for everybody to get the issues out there. Hopefully we'll get some debates going.
Okay. Any other announcements?
I took my papers out. I'm running again.
Laura, I'll be returning my papers in on Monday.
I should be too, actually.
Well, that's good to hear, because yours was kind of a trial run.
Yeah.
you got appointed, so this will be your first.
And I just wanted to say one more thing. I wanted to thank Pam for when it was needed and when somebody did it, we didn't have a Ward 1 elector, applicant, that you came out and that you put forth an awful lot of energy and that you attended different school functions and you weren't just a name only, you actually went out and did it. And I'd like to thank you for your service, even though I'll probably be thanking you when you leave, but I just want to say thank you.
Okay, next is our recommended actions. We have a vote by consent agenda. We have approval of minutes from the negotiating team meeting June 9th, 2015. School committee meeting June 11th, 2015. Budget and property subcommittee meeting, June 17th, 2015. We have a few contracts for and transfer approvals. Clark HVAC Services, annual boiler maintenance and emergency repairs, $15,450. FM Generator, Inc., annual generator inspections and maintenance, $3,640. United Elevator Company, Incorporated, annual elevator maintenance and emergency repairs, $14,400. Pearson Education, elementary math investigations materials, $21,059.15. Amendment to the LPVEC Medicaid reimbursement filing services contract, additional $13,591.89.
That's Lower Pioneer Valley Educational Collaborative.
Thank you. State Street Fruit Store produce for Northampton Public Schools Food Service, $40,000. All-Star Dairy Foods Food Service Program, $95,000. And G. Houston Beverages for the Northampton Public Schools Food Service Program, $25,000. We have one field trip request. Jackson Street, fifth grade, will be going to Nature's Classroom, Beckett, Mass., October 13th through the 16th, 2015. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Next, we have reports and recommendations. First up is our personnel report, and I'll turn that over to Ms. Walzak. We'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. It's my pleasure at this time to announce to you, although I've already done it through email, but for the first time appearing publicly in Northampton, our new food services director, John Trenfaglia. He is currently the director of food services and recycling coordinator for the Southern Berkshire County Regional School District. Prior to that, he served as the director of food services for the Lenox Public Schools. His non-public school experiences include dining and supervisory experience with Berkshire Health Systems in the Red Lion Inn. And I think he's going to be a very good addition to our team. I'd like to thank Candy Walzak and the search committee for bringing such a qualified candidate forward.
Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Would you like to address us at the microphone?
Absolutely. Again, my name's John I'm working on my shyness. My name's John Trenfaglia, and I've been living out in the Berkshires now for about 19 years. Little background on me. I've a lovely wife. I have two beautiful kids. I should say wonderful kids too, of course. It all depends on which day, what's going on. I've been in food service my entire life. That was just a little bit of what I've done. I'm actually from the Boston area, and I've run large restaurants in the Boston area. One of my favorite things that I did was I actually worked at the Cheers Bull and Finch Bar in the height of the season when the show was actually on. So it was a great time to, let's say, get over my shyness. I'll say that. It was a lot of fun. I love food service. I've been doing the public schools now for 14 years. 10 of those years, I was doing a joint between Lenox Public Schools and Southern Berkshire Regional. I was split time between the two of them. I love feeding the kids. I love taking care of the families. I love getting to know people. It's something that I just really enjoy. The food service part of it is a benefit of what I do. I like to be part of the community. And if you ask anyone in Southern Berkshire, if you ask anybody in Lenox, even out in the Boston area, people always remember like, oh yeah, John's a great guy. You know, he enjoyed doing what he's doing, and oh yeah, he can cook. So I get roped into a lot of that too. So I really, really enjoy, and I'm thankful for the opportunity to be able to come out to Northampton Public Schools and to start an additional career here. My goal is to retire someday, but plenty of years off. So you'll get to see me quite often. Hopefully we get to know each other quite well. And my door is always open anytime, 24/7. People say, oh, I don't want to email you late at night. I don't want to text you late at night. You'll get a reply. Parents will say to me all the time, especially in Southern Berkshire, they'll say, I texted you at 11 o'clock at night and you replied to me. Like, aren't you sleeping? I'm like, yeah, but my phone beeped. I have to answer it and take care of it. So please, if you have any questions, concerns, ideas, thoughts, I'm sure you will. I'm sure families will. Please feel free to get in touch with me. I'd love to just be able to figure out how to make it all work. So, but thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you. Forward, yeah.
Oh, I apologize. Is there any questions for me?
You said you're starting July 27th?
July 27th will be my first official day. So, off and ready to go. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next we have a series of votes.
Rest of the personnel.
Oh, yes. Backing up, we're going to hear the rest of the personnel report.
Rest of the personnel report. Okay. June's report, that time of year where we have people leaving the district, and I'm sure at the August report we'll have a long list of people coming into the district. Our separations this month, you've got the list of the 13 people that are leaving the district. It includes, to point out, I think everyone is aware, one of our associate principals, Matt Collins, has resigned and has taken a new job in the region. And then we've got a list of other staff members there. And we've also got a list of 10 retirees, and they were actually all honored at our last meeting, so I don't think we need to necessarily go through the names again, but we want to thank them. They represent a lot of years of service to the school district.
Okay, now we have a series of votes. The first item up for a vote this evening is a gift from the Bridge Street PTO for $34,000.
Yes, if we go back a few months, we had a $66,000 donation several months ago, which was actually, it was from the PTO, but it was also a donation from Dr. Melvin Herskowitz. This is an increase in his donation. When he found out that Bridge Street was celebrating their 100th anniversary this year, he increased the amount of stocks that he donated to the PTO, and they were able to sell those stocks working with his broker for a little over $100,000. So we're coming back tonight with the rest of the donation officially from the PTO, but also in recognition of the donation from Dr. Herskowitz.
Move to accept the gift with much gratitude.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I just want to say, wow.
Yeah.
I was talking to Dr. Provost about this beforehand, and it's amazing that when we have folks that give so much of themselves and then they go above and even beyond to come back and support the public schools financially, it almost creates a situation of unableness to show enough gratitude, and I believe in this case it's certainly one of those. This gift will definitely be used, as all the gifts are used, to do some really amazing things over there at Bridge Street. So.
I'd like to say it was so generous of Dr. Herskowitz to look at the significance and increase it to 100. It's so generous. It's just unbelievably generous that he did that. Thank you, sir.
Yes, Ms.
Will the additional money be going towards the same thing that the original $66,000 was going towards the computers, or is there going to be a different?
Some of it is going to additional behavior, technology-related items, such as some projectors and things to mount to use with the computers. But they're also looking at a climbing wall for the gym, similar to what's at Jackson Street. They're looking at some curriculum materials, some replacement of some desks with round tables to make a better setting for the students to work together.
That's great. It's a game changer.
All those in favor of accepting this gift, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Next, we have a gift from Stop and Shop in the amount of $7,190.98 to Northampton High School.
Yes, this is apparently an annual donation that comes through. We're formalizing it this year like we have with a lot of our other donations. This is a result of the A-plus rewards program that they have. So the people that have go in that have indicated they would like their points or their credits to go to Northampton Public Schools, Northampton High School, this is a result of. This money is actually split, as indicated on your paperwork, between the athletic revolving account and a general gift account for the high school that helps underwrite some of the other programs that go on at the high school.
Oh, well, I move to accept the gift.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, now discussion.
Yeah. It says to the high school, and I know with the A-plus rewards, that it can go to any of the different schools. So do we also get it for the other schools, or
I haven't received it yet. It might be that at the other schools it goes to the PTOs. That's just a guess, because this is the only one that I've seen come to the school department.
I thought it went to the principals, because when I was on the over at Ryan Road and working with them, I thought that it went through the principals. I thought that was one of the ones, because I was actually responsible for signing people up for it. And I just want to also mention that people can help an awful lot by just taking the time to sign up and associate their card, whether it be at Stop and Shop, or I'm not sure if Big Y still does it, because this is something that people already do, is shop, and all it does is just gives us free money, essentially. So I encourage people to go up and sign up their cards and register their cards for whatever school matters to you. But thank you.
Okay, there's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Next up, we have another gift from Target Corporation in the amount of $25 to Northampton High School.
Yep, this is from the Thanks a Billion Teacher campaign, a check that showed up unannounced at the high school that we would like to deposit into their gift account to use for programs at the high school.
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of accepting this gift, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Next, we have a gift, Northampton High School art students in the amount of $200 for art supplies.
Yes, the kids in Miss Leary's art class this year wanted to make a donation in her honor for the instructional and programs that she provided to them. So they chipped in and purchased a $200 gift card that they've donated to the school for her to be able to use for art supplies for that program. This came right from the kids.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, there's been a motion to accept and second this gift of the art supplies. Any discussion?
I would just like to thank the students. I think that's wonderful that they went out and they did something in the name of the teacher, just like the woman who came up today and had something nice to say about our teachers. I just think it's an awesome reflection of her work to be able to have the students themselves donate. So thank you.
All those in favor of accepting this $200 gift for art supplies, please say aye.
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 Next, we have a gift, JFK PTO, in the amount of $788.88 for student activities.
Yes, this is from the PTO to support the enrichment programs that go on at the school, and we are asking on this one that you vote to put that donation into the student activity account rather than the gift account, just so that it can be combined with other funds they have for the same student activities.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the gift to the PTO for the $788.80 for the student activities account.
All right, there's been a motion made to accept the gift. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Some discussion. Ms. Minnick.
My feeble brain, that you can hear the squeaking of the wheels. Is this not something that could have been accepted by the principal? Didn't we just approve a policy where we get to, like, do $1,000?
That policy has been put on hold because we're still dealing with the issue of gifts of material gifts.
Okay. Thank you.
But this will definitely be one that.
I told you it's squeaky. Thank you.
We'll get there.
Okay.
So we've had a motion to accept and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. The next two items are votes on surplus of materials. The first one is the surplus of 49 microscopes from Ryan Road Elementary School.
And I would just direct your attention to the single sheet of paper that has photographs of the two items that we're recommending be surplus tonight. The photograph on the top shows the 49 microscopes. I mean, I should say, 49 partial and complete microscopes. These are items that were in a closet that was being cleaned at Ryan Road School There were a number of working microscopes that have been separated from this lot for use in the school, but these are determined to be of no value by the teachers. Being scientific instruments, I'm sure they have some kind of value. I would estimate the total value of the whole lot to be about $1,000.
Is there a motion?
Move to, what are we moving to? Put it.
We're moving to surplus these 49 microscopes.
Okay, I will make the motion to vote to surplus the 49 microscopes from Ryan Road Elementary, and then I'll have my question.
Is there a second?
Second.
Can I ask what happens to all this stuff?
That's the question.
So what we will attempt to do is collect whatever money we can for the sale of the microscopes. It will go to the general fund, which will then hopefully recycle back to the schools in one form or another.
Thank you.
Sell them on Craigslist or what?
I really don't know how we will dispose of these, but the first step is getting a vote from the committee. I think that these, we may have some more luck with disposing than the ones that we'll be asking you to vote on next. But we'll obtain whatever value we're able to obtain for the city, because they were purchased with taxpayer funds, and we'd like to try to capture any kind of residual value they may have left.
Ms. Duvall.
We have the different preschool programs and whatnot, and are any of them able to be used, you know, for fooling around in a scientific way for the kids to have it on hand there?
I don't think these would really be appropriate for use by preschoolers.
Well,
yeah,
under supervision, of course, but.
I know that some of them are defective, some of them are missing pieces, some of them are really, truly not microscopes as much as they're sort of magnifying devices that are bought sometimes in kits with specially prepared slides, and the slides are no longer available, so I really don't see a use in this in the schools. I think probably the best use will be for someone who either recycles metal or optics.
Okay, there's been a motion to surplus and second. All those in favor of surplusing, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Next, we have another surplus up here, surplus of elementary school library books. And Mr. Provost will speak to us about those.
You will remember Mr. Winnick addressed the school committee not long ago with samples of some books that were being weeded from elementary libraries. I'm happy to report that the weeding process is done now. It yielded about 4,000 books that are so out of date that they are incorrect, inaccurate, in some cases borderline offensive, that we'd like to have removed from the libraries. In attempting to estimate a value for this lot, I consulted with Mr. Winnick, and the $2,500 is really a recycling potential value, because in his opinion, as a school librarian, the books really have no value as books.
I'd like to make a motion to surplus the elementary school library books.
There a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Anybody going to ask where these end up? Probably no.
They said recycling, so that's good to me. As long as we don't like put misinformation out, you know, you can't put them in a used book sale or donate them to the doctor's office or something because of that.
The different three of the four schools have a fundraising box out in front, and I know that they're worth at least 10 cents a pound. So depending on how much they weigh, then the PTOs would get them if you put them in the boxes, because I know 1 year Ryan Road did that, and they made over $1,500 that year. I mean, obviously some of it was clothes and stuff too, but it is worth at least 10 cents a pound.
How are the plans coming along to replace these books?
Well, the next step in the process is actually digitizing the books that we have in the library. So we haven't discussed replacement anywhere the extent that we've discussed trying to digitize what we currently have. I think before we bring in more books which need to be digitized, we want to focus on trying to digitize the remaining books, which are a lot. These 4,000 over four schools didn't decimate the libraries or leave them bereft of reading material. They just we wanted to make sure that we got rid of things that we didn't want before we started digitizing, because that would be wasted effort.
Okay, there's been a motion made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Next, we have a presentation and a vote of the 2015 to 2020 District Improvement Plan. I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. With your materials tonight, you received a proposed new District Improvement Plan, which will carry us through to 2020 with your approval. I should take some time to recognize the many people who worked on this. Specifically, I'd like to recognize school committee members Blue Duvall, Laura Fallon, and Ann Hennessy. Also, if you turn to page 2, you will see the entire group was comprised of 35 people who were representative of all walks of life within Northampton, representative of all the schools and different disciplines within the schools, and community members as well. And the community members ranged from providers, private school, private preschool providers, all the way up to Smith College at School of Education faculty. So I should also say that many of those people who worked on this plan are also here in the audience tonight to show support. And if my counting is right, and if we count Laura for the proofreading she did, I think the number of people who've worked on this plan in the room right now probably exceeds the number of people who didn't work on the plan. So I think it represents the collective wisdom of a number of people who care very deeply about the schools and who bring different levels of or different areas of expertise to the problems faced by our district. The methodology that we used in developing the plan was to begin by reviewing the root cause analysis. As you remember, there were 6 root causes that we identified as being of critical need to work on, and asking individuals to identify one cause that they would like to work on over the course of the plan development. So that was essentially the first meeting. At the second meeting, each of the teams that were developed by root causes was charged with developing one or more theories of action, which are statements that describe basically what's a plan, what do we think would help us get from the current state to where we want to be. And then in subsequent meetings, each group broke their theory of action down to strategic objectives and strategic initiatives. And at the final meeting, we developed a sequence for the objectives and initiatives. So in all, the plan has 10 new goals. We're carrying 3 goals over from the DIP that just expired because we weren't able to fully complete them by the end of the DIP period. There are 27 objectives and more than 75 initiatives. I believe that this plan directly addresses each of the 6 causes and really gives us an opportunity to affect change at a fundamental level. Because of its comprehensiveness and because of its scope, I would recommend that the plan have a 5-year window instead of a 3-year window. I am somewhat concerned about the number of initiatives, especially in the first years, but I'll say this. These were things that the group of people who gathered to work on the District Improvement Plan are highly motivated to do. And in fact, they were so motivated to do it, they really wanted to ensure that no goal was put on hold while we worked on other goals. So you'll see that the plan is front-loaded. There are many more initiatives in the first 3 years. I think that's good because I think it leaves some slack for initiatives that may have to ultimately be pushed off to year 4 or year 5. But I really think that it's a solid district improvement plan. I think it's actionable district improvement plan because it clearly lays out what we intend to do over the course of the next 5 years. It allows us to provide alignment to school improvement plans and personal professional development plans. And so I think it is a very good vision for the district going forward. And, you know, just two final comments. I'm sure that those who were part of the process can attest that my direction was really around process rather than product. And I just said, please give me solutions to these root cause problems. And I was really surprised that almost every group went to data. And the word data appears in this document, I think, 36 times. And that was without any prompting. And I also will say that all of the initiatives were developed without my direction or prompting, which makes me feel that there are a lot of people who are really motivated to try to take the district in a different direction. And as is often the case, I think that when you empower people to tell you what they'd like to do to make the school a better place, they're willing to take on a lot more than I would ever be able to get them to take on if I was mandating it. I think if this school committee does accept this plan, it will make my job of implementing it much easier because, as I said to one of the people who was basically commenting on sort of my direction on process rather than product, well, you know, this is really going to make my job a lot easier because when we get to implementing and enforcing the plan, I'm not going to say you need to do this because I'm the superintendent or you need to do this because the Department of Education says it. I'm going to say this is what you said you were going to do, so let's do it. I think it's interesting that in many cases the initiatives align directly with initiatives that the Department of Education is suggesting, and in other cases they're quite different from what the Department of Education is suggesting. So to me that's a sign that it is truly a locally sourced solution to problems, and I think that's helpful because I think that it's very difficult for an agency responsible for an entire state that has a great diversity of different kinds of districts to identify the best solutions for problems facing schools. But I think a community that's embedded in the context of its own schools has a much better sense of what needs to be done. And so that, I think having local solutions are going to be much better. And also, I'd point out that you'll notice that many of the initiatives within the action plan are cross-referenced to other initiatives that occur in other goals. So even though these six groups were working independently, they were coming to some highly similar initiatives. So there's a good synergy here, and many of the initiatives reinforce each other. So I'm very happy with the work that the committee did. I'm really grateful for the commitment for just about every person to show up for all five meetings, including one meeting that was held in the last week of school. And I think it's a solid plan for the committee.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the 2015 and 2020 district improvement plan.
Is there a second?
Second.
And any discussion?
Aye. I've discussed this. I was on the committee, and I've discussed this with many members of the community. And one question that some people have asked after, and I've been explaining to people, and I thought maybe you could explain just one time real quickly, is how the people were chosen to be on this committee, because that's one thing that I've been asked quite often.
Sure. So each of the six groups had an administrator who was assigned to sort of facilitate the process within their group. Those administrators were chosen essentially voluntarily from the ALT team. And then all of the members of the rest of the committee were volunteers. The call went out to all faculty through faculty meetings that I attended and went out to parents through the principals. And nobody who showed up was denied participation. Everyone who wanted to be a part of the process was able to be fit into a group. We even had a couple of cases where people shifted groups because once they started working on it, they realized that their interests were really with another group. But it was so voluntary participation by administrators and staff and parents, and then the community members were actively recruited by me. And the rationale between with my recruiting was that I wanted to try to get the full spectrum of pre-K to post-12 education included in the group, and that I also wanted to have significant or agencies that had significant contacts with the schools included, such as the NEF.
Thank you. I also wanted to, having worked with you on this, it was amazing how we all did come together with so many commonalities, and I actually had people ask if we had worked together as opposed to six independent groups, because there are so many overlaps. And I'd like to say that it was an honor to work with you, and that you left it very, very open for all of us to come up with our own basically plans and ideas. And you just did a wonderful job as an administrator. You were basically hands off other than being there for questions. And this really is a community driven plan based on your entry findings. So thank you.
Ms. Hennessy?
Actually three questions, but I'll just ask one since I see Laura has another one. You said, and this is more for the public, I think, how does this plan align with the state, and how does it not align? You said that it does both. Can you give an example?
Sure. So one area where I think there's a lot of overlap, and it runs throughout many of the goals, is the emphasis on data-based decision-making. And when we were talking about, or I shouldn't say we, but when the groups were talking about data, they were looking at all kinds of data, not just results of statewide tests, mm-hmm. but data about student attendance, data about teacher assessments, data about budgets. That type of a focus on trying to have a rational decision-making process that's grounded in data, I think is very consistent with a lot of the initiatives that the Department of Education recommends. Mm-hmm. Then there were other ones that I think were completely unique and very Northampton-centric, if you will, such as the goal to have a home visit, which is something that I think is very ambitious. I think it's potentially game-changing, mm-hmm. but I think it's something that you would be very unlikely to see coming from a state education agency.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Ms. Fallon?
I just want to ask, because I feel like it doesn't come through in this, was to mention, I think the best part of working on this was at the last meeting where groups were presenting their final project and trying to fit what they wanted to do into the timeline. Mm-hmm. And everyone was so excited and like lobbying for, they wanted theirs to start first. And so I just hope that if you read, that the public, if they read this and they're not clear, that they ask someone, because I think that was the most important part was to have the vision of why are we doing this? What is it that we're hoping to achieve? And to that excitement by all of the people who are a part of making this is kind of infectious. And I hope that people ask questions, that they don't just dismiss it or say like not feel a part of it, because I think that you can easily become a part of it even now by just engaging with the people who are responsible for doing it, because it's going to be obviously the entire community that's implementing it, so I feel like everybody really still has the opportunity to be involved.
Excellent point. Help us.
Mr. Meyer.
I just have a question. I mean, this is very ambitious. You have given the district 5 years. I'm just wondering about, have you and the other members of the administrative leadership team thought about how you will organize the reporting of the progress of various initiatives? Because I know that we see this now, obviously there's been a tremendous amount of work that's gone into it, but it's very important within those 5 years, if goals need to be adjusted, if course corrections need to be made, also if we're doing our job of informing the public and deliberating as a committee each year on budget priorities, I think the feedback from you is important as to which one of these goals are going forward. And I'm just thinking about what the instrument looks like. I mean, when you raise money, you put the thermometer up, you got zero, you got 100, it's really easy. Obviously, some of these are much more involved or difficult to sort of evaluate on a simple mm-hmm. scale like that.
So I think that the next step of this will be people proposing the goals in their school improvement plans and their individual educator goals. So that will give us sort of the first sense of being able to lay out a reporting timeline. I think that once we sort of identify within, at the building level and at the individual educator level, how these different initiatives are going to be implemented, then I'll have a better sense of how I'll report on that. And my vision for that is that I would be getting reports from principals based on what they're seeing with their educator teams and what they're seeing with the school improvement plans, and then I'd be bringing that forward to the committee so they'd be updated on the overall progress of the district improvement plan.
Is there any thought as to, I know that we have discussed at various times as a committee trying to calendar certain events. It's April, it's time to file your taxes. It's July, it's time to think about district improvement plan. And just wondering whether that might be something that we could do so that we all have an expectation that it's going to arrive, and sort of we can start to ask questions in advance of getting it so that we're better informed when it arrives.
Well, one of the things that I think is useful about this format of district improvement plan is that it does list what initiatives are supposed to be done in each year. So I think what I could do is make a recommendation to the committee about when it would make sense to get an update on what are the initiatives for year one, what are the initiatives for year two. My sense is that it would probably make most sense to do that sometime towards the end of the year. Just thinking sort of on the fly, I'm thinking May probably would be a good time because it would be after budget but before the final meeting.
Thank you.
Other comments?
Is this already up on the website?
No.
Is it going to be up on the website?
If the school committee approves it, certainly will be. Yes.
And has it been, it will be then sent to whom? To all the teachers?
So it'll be communicated to all the faculty, because this will be important as they begin their next process of goal setting. The next groups that will really work with this are the school improvement or the school councils, because they'll be developing school improvement plans based on our new timeline in the policy. Those are due October 1st. So they'll be adjusting school improvement plans to fall into line with these initiatives. And then when principals meet for goal setting meetings with educators for their evaluation process, I'm sure they'll be identifying specific educators with specific goals.
Anyone else? Well, I would simply say that knowing that the people that were on the committee, hearing from you this evening, it's always great to hear that it was fun, it was invigorating, there was a lot of energy involved, because sometimes when you think of a district improvement plan, it seems like it's just work. This seems like it's a roadmap to take us to where our new superintendent has identified things through his entry findings and his root cause analysis that takes us through step by step, albeit for 5 years. I mean, with the different initiatives and the amount that are there in front of us, it wouldn't be prudent for us to think that it could be done in 6 months or a year. So looking at it over a five-year plan with steps along the way, and as Dr. Provost said, the enforcement of the programs and the effort put forward to implement these changes, for me just sounds really, really exciting. And to know that everyone that was involved in working on the committee feels the same way, I think just gives more energy to the entire district and to the parents and ultimately the students, who will be the beneficiaries of the hard work that we're all going to undertake over the next 5 years. So a special thanks to all of you that were on the committee and all of you out there in the audience and watching at home, parent, teacher, and any other folks that got involved. Thank you very much. And at this time, I will ask us to take a vote to approve the 2015 to 2020 district improvement plan. So I would ask you to say aye if you're in agreement with me right now. Aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, next we have a report, Superintendent Evaluation Team Report. And I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Ann Hennessy.
Great. So, Ms. Minnick and Ms.
Nikorchek were, and I were on the superintendent evaluation committee, and I'll just explain for everyone in the public what this means. At the end of each year, there's a summative evaluation for the superintendent, and Dr. Provost is rated on three goals, a professional practice goal, student learning goals, and district improvement. And then that's one set. And then there are four standards that he's rated on, and they are instructional leadership, management and operations, family and community, and professional culture. So what we did was Dr. Provost sent us a lot of evidence, basically, for all of those standards and goals. We brought to the meeting our knowledge of him through these meetings and other information that we've gotten from him or about him, and then we rate him. So what this document is, and we will be voting on the rankings, not necessarily the narrative that we have, which is just really the evidence. And so I'll just kind of go over each goal briefly, if that's okay, and then I'll go the standards, because there's a little bit, it's a daunting process, I think, for people who are just new to this. The first goal was a professional practice, and he set out to obtain the SEI, or Sheltered English Immersion, license by June. He met that goal as he completed the class that the state offers. His second goal, a student learning goal, was to improve ELA and math MCAS scores, and we put some progress on that, as we don't have the data yet back from the state, which is where the timing of this is strange. His district improvement goals, he has three of. One was to complete the current district improvement plan, one was to present the entry findings, and the other was to develop the next district improvement plan. And we put significant progress on that and not met, only because we still needed to vote on this. So before I go into the standards, do you guys have any questions about those goals? Yeah,
Blue. Well, I just have one question right off. Is the district improvement goal, well, actually I have two questions, significant progress because we haven't voted on it. So once we vote on it tonight, you're going to go back and have it.
The summative ended then, unless you disagree, Dr. Provost. No. It just didn't get it in for the summative. It doesn't hurt him at all that he didn't meet it. It's just...
Oh, I'm not worried about that. I'm wondering about just the bigger picture, is that had it been voted on, would that have changed? I mean, is that the only game changer right there? Okay. Yeah. My other question was, as the data hasn't come back in on the student learning goals, and the categories are such that, why some progress? I mean, it seems like it would be non-applicable.
Except the state doesn't give you that.
So you just...
Well, Dr. Provost, in conversation, we felt like there was some progress made. We couldn't put significant, didn't meet, met, or significant. We felt, given the kind of the rankings that it had, that was the best of the options.
Okay, so based on what data did you use, is my question, I guess.
What the real numbers that you received already, not the CPI. Do you want to explain?
Right. So districts received preliminary data at the end of June. The data is incomplete and it's embargoed so that it can't really be shared or discussed, and it's not finalized, and it only really includes ELA. So based on some of the indications that we saw in that data, I felt that some progress could certainly be warranted, but the other data just isn't in yet.
Okay. Well, that was my question. I mean, we had to pick some category and there wasn't one, so how did we, and based on preliminary findings that we can't see.
And oddly, it will always be like that.
Yes.
So we'll never have.
Just because of the timing of it?
Yes. Yes.
That can't be adjusted?
It's
or is that a state?
It's a state.
Unless you know someone we can talk to you about.
I say oddly, and there are other words.
But on the bright side, you'll never get did not meet.
Exactly.
That's right.
That's true. And then there are four standards. So let me actually step back for 1 second. And the state is really clear that a first-year superintendent in a district, it is very difficult to get proficient. It's not that we should just be assuming that a superintendent earns this right to proficiency. But yet when we looked at the data, it was very clear, I'm going to use data again, it was very clear that in each of the standards, Dr. Provost had clearly met the proficient standards. So all of us at the end of the day, at the end of looking at all this evidence, we compiled it, and as a subcommittee, we voted on it. And for each standard, we deemed him proficient, and then the overall goal is, overall rating was proficient.
You mentioned data. I'm just wondering what data was used for that.
Which one? Standard?
Well, actually, any of them. You pick.
Sure. I mean, you have included Mr. Vall in or your packet or what was sent, what Dr. Provost sent to us. Mm-hmm. So the evidence.
So that's what, okay.
Yeah, so a lot of that. Also, school committee meetings, some of the evidence was presented in there. But for example, information he got at walkthroughs, the number of units that were developed, plans, procedures, and routines in terms of setting up fire drills, information that he work that he'd been doing with the Rini Center, with working with the association, a DESE visit, which really indicated a high level of parental and family involvement in the district. What else? There's so much evidence.
Well, I'm not asking because I disagree with any of it. I personally have seen an awful lot of what he's done. I was just wondering how it was measured when it came down to it, and what actual data that you do use, and I'm getting the answer, so thank you. Yeah. I just think in some areas he's been exemplary, so that's why I was wondering the data that you were using. I mean, you know, proficient, and then also possibly needs improvement. Not that I would be the one to gauge that, but you know, after being 1 year, so
I think what you guys could speak at too. One thing that was very clear to me that stood out in this evaluation was how clear Dr. Provost was of where he feels like he needs to improve. For example, looking at social emotional and behavioral issues in the district, working to include even more families in different period, I guess. So I felt like he was very clear about where he was going, what he's been doing, very reflective. And I agree. I mean, there were a lot of issues, a lot of the standards we, you know, proficient, he was solidly proficient. And I think exemplary is really hard, and you have to continue to model it and show even more. And I think that's where he's moving. I don't have any.
I was just thinking, as a first-year superintendent for our district, I think that he's an exemplary.
Absolutely.
That's all I'm saying.
Yes.
Based on that.
And the state thinks that for the first 3 years that you have to become proficient for a new superintendent. So, yeah, I agree with you though.
Ms. Fallon?
I was just going to say, because I, of course, looked up, I was like, oh, he's only proficient. He like, I thought he was better than that. And they do, for people who don't have this information in front of them, exemplary, they describe as being a rating of exemplary indicates that practice significantly exceeds proficient and could serve as a model of practice regionally or statewide. So I get it. I think you're on track, though.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
I'm worried. You're staying, right?
Good.
He's got 5 years worth of stuff.
Yeah, I can't go anywhere.
Other comments or questions for Ms. Hennessy?
Okay. I just have a comment. I want to thank the three of you for doing it. I mean, just the questions that I have, and it just seems intangible for you all to be able to sit down and actually find answers and be able to justify the answers that you found, and to be able to categorize it, because I agree with Ms. Fallon that exemplary is definitely something that he's on track to doing, and I wouldn't want the job of judging what he's done in a very objective way, because he's done so much that's just subjective, that just has brought a new feel and a new openness to the district. And I'm excited right now. I mean, excitement with the district improvement plan, and I think that that he's done a wonderful job. So I just wanted to make sure that everyone knows that proficient means a wonderful job, too.
It really does.
It really does. Yeah. So thank you.
When you look at the form that needs to be filled out, it can be kind of intimidating. I think as an educator myself, having to fill out something similar, it can be overwhelming at times when you're not familiar with it, but as we continue to use this tool to evaluate administrators and staff, becomes more user-friendly, and it becomes easier and easier to identify data that can be then used to meet or to be attached to a standard. And in many cases, there's overlap. I think we've heard that part of our discussion this evening with the district improvement plan, where you can see where a couple different things are working at once. And I know in my own evaluation that's true, and I'm sure as you looked at Dr. Provost and his success with us here in the district, you saw many areas where you could use multiple pieces of data to support many of these standards. And I'm very happy to endorse this and his proficient work here in the district with the continuation of seeing him grow over the next several years. Ms. Minnick?
This is a little bit to the side of the actual evaluation and the document and the approval, but just from a historical perspective, I would say that I have been a part of hiring a number of superintendents over my tenure as a school committee person. And each of those people, when they were hired, it was the right person at that moment. It was someone who had the characteristics and the skills that we needed right then. It was what we were looking for. But without taking anything away from any of the previous superintendents with whom I've worked, I just want to say that Dr. Provost is like the whole package. He seems to have been what we needed at the time, and his entry plan proves that. His entry plan findings and his root cause analysis shows that he is very much more analytical and reflective than some other people might have been in the same situation. But his commitment and his just the excitement that he sees in describing how excited other people are about the district improvement plan makes me think that he's not just the right person for right now, but I think he's the right person for a while. And so, like you, I hope that he's here long enough that he gets to enjoy achieving the goals that he's put out in front of him. So
I just have a question for the superintendent. How did you feel that the evaluation process went from your position?
I think the evaluation process is good. It's sometimes I would agree that it can be intimidating when you look at all the forms and all the standards and how high that exemplary bar is, even how high that proficient bar is. But I think the five-step process forces you to take a break from doing the job to think about how you're doing on the job, and I think that's very healthy. I also think it's good that this is a process. You know, I'm the only one in the district that has it done publicly, but every other educator in the district is going through this as well. And I think if there's one thing I'd like the public to understand from this is how seriously we take evaluating staff and improving staff and in thinking about our own practice. If you think about what's happening tonight in the discussion of the superintendent's evaluation, multiply that by 300 for the number of employees in the district, and you know that there are a lot of very deep conversations going on about, okay, so here is the standard. Are you making the standard? What can you change to exceed the standard? How can you get on that path of being not only an educator who does all the aspects of the job well, but someone who can be a model for others statewide, which is really the goal that we have for every educator in the district. Pushing practice to that level, I think, is something that any parent should feel very happy is happening for their children and their children's teachers in the district. So I'm very much a supporter of it, even though it is time-consuming, it's daunting. I think overall the benefits outweigh the costs.
Thank you.
And thank you for all that you've done, too.
Any other comments or questions? Okay. Hearing none, I would ask us to vote on this. I'm going to ask for a roll call vote, just because I can. I think because it's such a...
Just because you can.
You'll take that good.
Just because you can.
So this would be a roll call vote to accept the superintendent's summative evaluation for his first year with us.
Was there a motion?
Do we have a motion?
I'd like to move to approve.
I thought you did.
I'm not sure I voted. Move to approve. I'd like to move to approve the superintendent's summative evaluation report form.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, and we did have some discussion. Is there any other discussion? Okay, so.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Mr. Howard Horn?
Yes.
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 And Mr.
Yes. Thank you very much. Okay, next up is a report of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. We have several first readings coming our way. I'll turn that over to the lovely Miss Lisa Minnick. Oh, sorry. To Miss Minnick.
Talented.
You'd be lovely.
Talented.
The bright.
Bright. You could add a lot of it. thank you, Mr. Suhafi. So I think I don't remember what order they're in, and my thing keeps going to sleep here. So if looks like the first one, and thank you, by the way, for the written ones. Purchasing file, it's policy number DJ. And the change in this policy was explained by the superintendent in his email this afternoon. If you did not read it, I will try and do as good a job as he did. The school committee, based on our existing policy, had a limit of $4,000 for contracts had to be issued for certain things in excess of a certain amount, and it said contracts had to be issued in excess of $4,000. The city's threshold for that is currently at $10,000. The language that we're proposing is to bring us in line with the city so that we don't have to revise our policy every time they revise their threshold. So we've just said we're just tying ourselves to their threshold for issuing contracts, because it will be a city even though it's the school department. It was.
So are you saying that they always need to be the same as that theirs was 4,000 and they raised it to 10 and this is 20?
They've raised theirs a number of times over the past some years, and ours hadn't kept up. We haven't changed our policy. Ms. Walsack maybe could speak to that.
But so they're supposed to be the same?
They don't need to be, but ours could be lower. But it's a more streamlined process if it can be the same. They do have the right, since we're Department of the City, to set the threshold we have to use. So we have to do a contract currently at $10,000. You could set it lower, but that just adds more paperwork to the whole purchasing process.
You can't make it be $12,000 because it's above the city, but right. But ours could be tighter, more restrictive, but there's no reason for it to be that we see.
I just thought our budget was smaller than theirs, so maybe we would have. I was just trying to figure out.
It just how has it to do with whether or not we're issuing a contract for something or just doing it based on, you know, you don't have to actually approve the contract. It can be part of a purchase order on the bill warrant without having to be a contract. Okay. We have to sign. We have to get 5 school committee signatures on a contract. And then the next one we get to is about bids, and it's even more complicated.
Okay. So this will keep us with the same threshold as the city was.
We're just aligning ourselves with the city. We can't go above them, but there's no reason for us to be approving contracts, more and more contracts, because our threshold is so much lower than theirs. We were just trying to eliminate the number of contracts that the school committee actually has to approve.
I just have a question. It says that was taken out was required bidding procedures and awards. So they're still going to bid on the contracts? I mean, does that have anything to do with any? Oh, we're going into bidding next is what you said?
Well, there is some question about bidding. We were trying to decide, would you help me?
The bidding threshold is actually $35,000. So that's all governed by state law. So it really didn't really need to be a reference in here to bidding and contracts because state law says you must bid. The contracts is more of a local issue. The state law doesn't require a contract.
Okay.
And can we have a brief primer on the difference between a contract and a purchase order which has contractual language on it?
Depends which attorney you talk to.
How about this one?
In Northampton, there is a multi-page contract which is used through the city procurement office, which is called a contract. We do purchase orders on everything we buy, and in some cases that purchase order is deemed to be a legal contract, and it is even here a legal contract, but the city goes one step higher on those contracts in excess of $10,000 by doing a multi-page contract rather than just a simple purchase order. But there are other places that don't use contracts unless you have done a bid, and they use purchase orders right up to $35,000. So it's really a local procurement office method of operating.
You good? Mm-hmm. Howard, you good with that?
I'm good with that. I don't quite understand.
Okay, so in again, the change that we were recommending to the policy on purchasing is simply to eliminate this specific dollar amount of the threshold and just tie it to the city, which currently is at $10,000, but if they change theirs next week, ours will be whatever theirs is. Okay, the second policy that's been given you for information purposes and a vote next time would be policy DJH, which is about contracts, and you it's may or may not be obvious, but we pretty much just I say we somebody pretty much deleted all of the language from the old policy on contracts and put new language that replaces it, and it this one has to do with things that, or at least the second paragraph has to do with things that are bid. And maybe Ms. Walsack could explain this one to you as well. Yes. I seem to be stammering and not doing the right job of it.
Actually, we'll go to the second paragraph, new paragraph, and go back to the first paragraph. That might make more sense. So you've got a stack of contracts. You can't go home for a while tonight. Because you've got to sign all these contracts that you approved earlier on the agenda. Part of what we're looking to do is to streamline the procurement process. It's one of the things that's really taken me by surprise coming here with how many steps are involved in order to do purchases, especially for a district this size. So what we're trying to do is not have to have you sign every contract, but to allow you to delegate signing authority to the superintendent for the contracts. What we've come up with as, I guess we call it a compromise, a middle plan, is to say that when we have a contract, the contract will be scanned to the school committee members, and you'll have 48 business hours, I think was the wording we settled on, two business days. Of that email going out, if you have a question, to get back to the superintendent and ask the question or say that you have a concern and you'd like it placed on the agenda. If three members of the committee ask to do that, it will be not signed by the superintendent. It will be placed on an upcoming school committee meeting, and then we can have that discussion on it. If they're routine contracts, which since I've been here, probably 95% of them have gone through without really any issues, like tonight's are all annual contract renewals, basically. If nobody has any questions, or at least three of you don't have a question within that 48 hours, then the contract will be signed by the superintendent. It will just allow us to streamline. Some of these contracts have been sitting in my office for a couple of weeks waiting for tonight's meeting. So this would allow us to streamline the contract, but give you a way, if you see a contract you have a question about, to basically hold us signing it until it comes to the committee for discussion. If we are bidding something, though, those are really the big contracts. The bid threshold is $35,000. Those are the bigger purchases we do, and we don't have a lot of them. We bought a bus this year. Periodically, we do a five-year bus contract. That's a really big one. If we're doing a bid, the first paragraph in the revision says that the contract won't be signed until the school committee votes to award that bid, and at the same time, we will be asking you to authorize the superintendent to then sign the contract. So when we're going out to buy a bus, we will bring you the results of the bid. You will vote to award the bid to XYZ company, which a lot of school committees currently do already. And in the same motion, we'll be saying you vote to award the bid to XYZ Bus Company in the amount of X, and you authorize the superintendent to sign the contract. Typically, those contracts are more detailed than what you get on the routine stuff. If you think back to when you did the last bus contract, you know, the specs are actually part of the contract, and they were, I'm taking a guess, I haven't looked at Northampton's, but they're usually about this thick, covering every nuance. So those contracts would come to you by way of having you vote the bid award and authorize the superintendent to do the contract. The stuff that's routine, we're trying to streamline and let that stuff move along quicker.
So at the end of the evening, when we all stay after and sign, we won't be doing that anymore, or we'll just have a few, or how do you see it actually changing for us?
You won't be doing it.
At all.
So what'll happen, like this stack of contracts would have been, there's five copies of each, so it's a little more intimidating, but a copy of each of these contracts would have been emailed to you, scanned and emailed to you, and if nobody objected, to use that word, or nobody questioned, then 48 hours later, the superintendent could sign these contracts and we could move on with the business that needed to be done. If three of you had questions or concerns, it would not be signed. It would be placed on the next agenda, and you could have the same discussion that you basically have now.
But if this, this is an incentive for you to read your email in a timely fashion. Forced compliance.
I think that my only concern is that you can, the number of having three, because if I have a really strong objection to something, that's not enough to put it on the agenda is what I'm understanding. But because of open meeting law, I can't actually contact more than a few people. Like, to get to that number, if somebody says, oh, I think it's fine, or I haven't read it yet, and I will go to the next person, it's very possible that I wouldn't get, you know, explained to someone like, this are my concerns.
I'm not sure that she can.
Like, I feel like we're kind of precluded to, so essentially it's us on our own thing, and I feel like that's, sometimes I don't realize that I do have a problem with something until someone else points it out, and I'm like, oh, you're right, I didn't think of it that way. Do you know? And so that's my only issue with it, was the number three. I feel like if one person objects that strongly, because typically we don't, do you know? I mean, I think it would have to be something that was very concerning. That's my only issue, or even two people, but setting it at three, it makes it very difficult to not.
But even one, if one person has some good points that other people hadn't looked at the ramifications of or thought about, I mean, I do agree with Laura. I think three is a very high threshold. And I think one person that has a very valid point should be enough.
So the way we discussed it in rules and policies was that three automatically put it on the agenda, but certainly if someone had serious concerns and replied to the superintendent, then he could use his discretion and include it on the agenda. It wasn't saying that you absolutely, to get it on the agenda, that you absolutely had to have three.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, because it's difficult, because we're precluded from calling up and talking to another person on the for open meeting law to start, you know, getting people to take our side or see our point. I mean, it just has to just be just generic, just coming up and seeing the point.
But it's you know, talking to the superintendent and...
So we can strongly object, and you'll say, okay, you're only one, but because you strongly objected, we might take it to the board anyway.
Hey, I think I have like three things I want to say. First of all, this policy is here for information, so you can think about this for a month and come back next month, and if somebody wants to make an amendment to it, that'll work. The second thing I want to say is that open meeting law does preclude a majority of people getting together and discussing something on which they're going to take any kind of action. But you can call one person and then call another person and then call another person. You all can't get together in the same place and talk amongst yourselves. You can call.
Yes.
You can call. I can call everyone on the
call. But we can't call
them. But you can't call us into.
You can't do a reply all.
Yeah.
Right. You can't reply all.
You can't say let's everybody meet.
I'm not real sure on that.
You can do. Sure about.
Yeah. There's a little bit of iffiness there.
You just have to be very, very careful that you do not disclose the content of the conversation with the previous people, or you have serial.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. There's the problem.
It's err on the side of caution.
Yes. Well, you may want to do that, but you can talk to individuals.
Changing.
If you like. So I just wanted to clarify that you could contact people and say you had this concern and ask them if they had a similar concern. You don't have to say, also Downey has that concern. It's just you and me talking. But now I will let, so excuse me for butting in.
Oh, it's fine. I really don't think I have that much more to add to it, but I think what I would be evaluating is the nature of the concern. So, for example, if one member of the committee said, I think this company is about to declare bankruptcy, the fact that it was one would not stop me from saying, oh, okay, that's a reason to put the brakes on here.
You said I don't like those people because I think they're shady.
Right. I just keep coming back to you and your mentoring telling me, I trust that if I brought something to this superintendent,
right,
that he would be reasonable and know the difference. But if we're making policy, it's going to apply to every superintendent, to every committee member. And do you want them to be in the position of deciding whose concerns are valid and whose aren't, or if he has a bad relationship with someone? You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
And so because it's policy, I just want to be careful that we're not writing policy that we aren't 100% behind.
Mm. Well, and I agree with you that it's not that common that we have people who take exception to a contract that's being considered. So if you want to make a motion to amend this when we get around to the vote part, I think it could certainly be warranted if you come up with the right language.
Sure.
To make it just be,
Mr. Meyer,
if there is question about a policy, then it will be put on the agenda.
Yeah, I mean, we will come back to this, but I guess it just goes to the fact that we have to distinguish between whether we are an executive body in terms of day-to-day operations of the public schools. And I think that what the business administrator has pointed out, that when the business of the schools is held up and supplies are not available for teachers and equipment does not arrive in a timely fashion because of our meeting schedule, I suppose that one solution would be to go back to bi-monthly meetings. And so I think that, you know, from my perspective, when this was discussed at the budget and property meeting, I thought that the threshold of three, again, is something that you could call two other members and say, I'm concerned. You don't even have to say the rationale, which I don't even think, you know, I'm not even sure that's a subject for deliberation under open meetings law, but you can say, I'm concerned. Would you also email the superintendent? Mm-hmm. So I don't think the policy sets a really high bar, and of course if it's not high enough, it's our policy. We're free to change it. If you know, if a superintendent came in who was abusing the discretion, we would just change the policy.
Okay, so you can think about this one for a month. See what happens next month. The next one is file ACA, non-discrimination on the basis of sex. And this particular policy, you will notice that the change is a very tiny little reference to one of the legal citations. So this is really a housekeeping thing to make it refer to the proper law. Anybody has a problem with that, you can take that up with the state. And the last policy that we're considering is BEC on executive sessions. And again, all of the changes that are shown here, to my knowledge, are just to bring us into compliance with the law as stated, the open meeting law, which was changed. And I don't think our policy was updated to reflect all of the open meeting law changes. Any questions on that?
Ms. Fallon and then Mr. Meyer.
My only question was, so we're now voting on the second reading, so next month, that's the vote, right?
Yeah, it was included in your packet, which is
right.
The first thing stated. It was brought to you tonight, which was the second thing in the process, and it'll be brought to you again next month, which is the third step in the process.
Right, so we're voting. That's
so we will, yes, we will
vote. I need to know how prepared I need to be.
So we will vote on it next time, that vote could be, I mean, there could be a motion to approve it, and then it could be sent back to the subcommittee. It could be held, you know, post discussion can be postponed as we did with one of the other policies. But mm-hmm. Presumably the motion will be to approve it, and then there would be any amendments made in the meeting.
Mr. Meyer?
I'm sorry to circle back, but I at the meeting of budget and property, I did ask a question about the section 49A, which is the declaration that's on all contracts for goods and services about taxes, and I asked about how that would interact if we were going to a purchase order driven system, and I don't know whether you had gotten any information about what the state thought about that.
I actually don't remember that question, so I'm
sorry. Okay, yeah.
But we aren't proposing to change anything about our system except that it's so we're not having a purchase order driven system, we're just having the superintendent sign the contracts instead of the school.
No, I'm actually going back to the I'm going back to the first one because contracts when you sign a contract with a municipality, you're required to say that you have paid all taxes and child support. And so obviously if you're not signing a contract, you're getting around that. The state wants you to give up your taxes when you sign a contract with anyone, with any municipality or state agency. So I didn't know whether as a purchase order replaces that, the state doesn't get that assurance. I don't know whether DOR would.
I'll have to check on it, but I will tell you that almost every school system I've checked with does not do contracts at $10,000. They use purchase orders, so my gut feeling is it's perfectly allowed, but I'll double check it when Joe Cook gets back from vacation.
I'm done.
You're done. Okay, thank you very much. Next, we have the business administrator's report.
We're getting close to the end of the year, but we're not quite there yet. But on a preliminary closing, it looks like we're going to end the year in a little better shape than we had thought. If you recall, we had planned to cover the utility bills out of the local budget to give us a better, more consistency going forward, which meant I expected that we would have a deficit of about $480,000 in the local budget that we would have to adjust with school choice where we had planned to pay the utilities. And it looks like we're probably going to be closer to $200,000. So that will leave us a little additional money in the school choice account going forward into our five-year plan that we talked during the budget process. So it looks like we're going to end up a little better than we had originally hoped that we would, despite increases in utilities and special ed. And then the last piece is just to publicly acknowledge one of the donations that came in substantially more than they had projected. The local vocal cord bowl took place a few months ago. They had come to us and asked you to accept a donation in advance so they could do the advertising that the money would come to us. They've completed, they held that function in March, I believe it was, and they've completed the donation to us. And instead of the $1,800 that they had estimated they would be donating, they donated a total of $3,140 to us that has been distributed to all of the school music programs to buy materials for their programs. So it was almost double the donation that they had originally anticipated.
Questions to the business administrator? Okay. We're on to the superintendent's report. Dr. Provost.
Thank you very much. As you know, there are many capital improvements being made to the Northampton Public Schools this summer. A few weeks ago, we broke ground on the Jackson Street Playground Project. I have to tell you, it was the most unique playground or any kind of groundbreaking I've ever been to. I remember saying to someone as I was walking in, oh, I should have brought my hard hat because I've been fortunate enough to be at a few of these, and usually the big people get hard hats and get to play with shovels. But at Jackson Street, it was the kids who actually broke ground. So that was a very heartwarming event, and it will be a good improvement for that school. As you also know, we have roofing projects going on at Ryan Road and Leeds. So far, Ryan Road has been stripped and new insulation on the roof has been installed above the gym section. The back section of the building has also been stripped and replaced. Crews are now working on the middle and front sections of the building. At Leeds, the mason is gearing up for work. There is some flashing that we're replacing before we start on the roof, so that's moving forward as first phase. Then when the roofers finish up at Ryan Road, we expect that the mason will be done and they can go and take care of that roof as well. So everything at this point appears to be on schedule for a substantial completion date of August 14th. We also have a Dectron project going on at JFK Pool. The new Dectron unit is anticipated to come sometime the end of August. And it is estimated that construction will take 3 to 4 weeks. So we are coordinating with our PE staff at at JFK and the Recreation Department. There will be a tiny impact on September PE classes in the pool, but I think given the improvement that we think the Dectron will make to air quality, that's a good trade-off to make. So this project will include demolition of the exterior walls because the Dectron is not something that you can just disassemble and carry out a door. You actually have to take down the wall to get it out. And then it will be, the old unit will be hoisted out and the new one will be put in and the wall will be replaced. We're also in the process of scheduling Wi-Fi installation at Jackson Street, Ryan Road, and Bridge Street. That will complete the district-wide Wi-Fi project. We will also be deploying a total of 90 new computers this summer at the four elementary schools. These are additions to the fleet, not replacements, because the existing computers at the elementary schools are still very functional. So we should have more access and better access for kids. So I think that parents and students will be pleased when they return to school to see all the improvements that we've made to physical plants and technology infrastructure. I'm also happy to report that the state budget that emerged from conference committee was significantly better for our schools than some of the scenarios we were looking at earlier in the budget season. The kindergarten grant that we talked so much about has been restored. Chapter 70 was maintained at the $25 per student level, and Circuit Breaker was fully funded. Of course, fully funded is a unique definition for Circuit Breaker, but better than we thought it was. So I really want to thank all of you who reached out to your legislatures on this, because all of the feedback I've been getting from the various professional organizations is that the advocacy of local officials made a big difference in this year's budget. So good work to all of us on that, I think. So hopefully there'll be no vetoes. I think we have 9 more days left for vetoes, so keep our fingers crossed till then. Also, I wanted to bring to your attention that DESE is working toward a different method to calculate low income as it impacts school finance and grant programs. For many districts, including us, this is an important issue with respect to finance. The reason the new method is being implemented is a result of the U.S. Department of Agriculture institution of the community eligible provision, better known as CEP, where it changed eligibility factor to receive lunch. The result for the old method of identifying free lunch is being phased out, and a new method is being required of the states beginning in FY16. It's important to note that this is a completely different measure of economic need. It's not comparable to the old free and reduced lunch numbers. It's kind of sad to say that the entry findings are already outdated, because you won't be able to go back and compare trends prior to 2016, because the new number is in no way comparable to the old number. So according to information provided by DESE, currently 38.3% of Massachusetts students are classified as low income. Under the new definition, 26.3% will be classified as economically disadvantaged. Many funding formulas, including Chapter 70, are driven primarily by the low income, or now what will be called economically disadvantaged ratio. This is predicted to have varying effects in different communities. Some will see more money, some will see less. At this point, we haven't had an opportunity to analyze it to the extent to know what the potential impact for Northampton will be, but I will keep you informed of that. I'm certain that it will be a big topic of discussion at the Executive Institute, which takes place later this month for superintendents. And then finally, at your places tonight, you saw a draft letter from Attorney Peasy. At the last school committee meeting, you asked me to contact the school committee attorney for a strongly worded letter that could be used for some of our parents who have a large amount of outstanding debt. I would ask you to just look that over, and if you have any suggestions for changes, please let me know and I will forward those to Attorney Peasy. And that's my report.
Ms. Minnick.
You mentioned the Chapter 70 funding, that foundation formula, mm-hmm. funding for foundation formula. Can you, what's the status of the changes to that besides the economic indicator?
So the Foundation Formula Committee, as I'm sure you'll recall, it was holding a series of hearings across the state, including a hearing that was held at Northampton High School. The committee has submitted its preliminary report to the legislature. The essential recommendation at this point is that there would have to be an additional $1 billion in the foundation formula in order to bring it up to a reasonable estimate of the true cost of educating individuals, which would mean that the state funding, since it funds approximately half of that, would go up $500 million. It's only preliminary finding at this time because the commission wants to fine-tune special education and health insurance measures a little bit more. I think I feel good about several things in that report. One of the things is that on basically every issue where Northampton officials testified that changes need to be made, the committee was recommending changes. Obviously, other officials in other communities had similar concerns. I guess, you know, it's about half as much as the superintendent's group feels the true number is based on some of the analyses we've done. But certainly, $1 billion would make a significant difference for kids in the Commonwealth and in Northampton. So my hope is that the foundation final report will look substantially similar to the preliminary report. And then my further hope is that the legislature phases it in a way that results in meaningful change, meaning that I hope that the increases to Chapter 70 aren't offset by decreases to other education funding programs. I also hope that the horizon for bringing it in, because I don't think anyone feels it's reasonable that it could happen in a single budget season, but is not so long that by the time the program is fully phased in that the formula is again sort of out of whack. So that is separate then from this issue of changing from low income to economically disadvantaged, but it's related. And I think that's one of the reasons why further adjustments will need to be made, because a great portion of the amount of Chapter 70 funding that flows to the district is based not only on the overall headcount, but the headcount within the what was the low income category. Now it'll be the economically disadvantaged category, which is going to be smaller for everybody. So you would assume the adjustment would have to be that the increment is higher for everybody. But we don't know if it will be uniformly lower for everybody by the same percentage. You know, it's kind of hard to know at this point where all the different communities will end up on that new metric. I imagine that some will probably see more money, some will probably see less, but that remains to be seen.
So free and reduced lunch remain, that the school lunch program is not touched by this. They still do their same calculation, because we have a number of things that we as a district have tied to that. So that's...
Yes, the free and reduced lunch program will still, is my understanding, run as it has. This is just a different metric that the state is using to identify kids who have economic needs.
Will it affect their eligibility, the kids? I mean, when you're talking about going from 30-something percent down to 26%, does that mean... See, the part that confuses me is at the same time I'm hearing that the gap is getting... We're losing our middle class, we're getting more lower, more higher, and less in the middle, but the number itself isn't reflecting that, so I'm kind of... confused?
Yeah, well, I think that a lot of us are trying to take this in and understand what it means right now. All that I've seen so far is that it should not throw kids who are currently eligible into a non-eligible category. I think it really remains to be seen in final regulations whether or not that, in fact, is the case.
Ms. Hennessy, then Ms. Minnick.
Where can we, being the public and us, see this, and what do you think we should do in terms of I'm sensing, in terms of my opinion, I don't think this is a good thing, but I'm sensing you agree with that. And what voice do we have in this?
So there is a PowerPoint that Desi has on this, which I can forward to you and I could make available on the website for individuals who are interested. I really think at this point that it's too early for me to have an opinion on whether this is going to have a good effect, a bad effect, or no effect on Northampton, because I don't know what we will do, or what will be done, I should say, with the economically disadvantaged increments to offset the losses from the current low-income increments. So I think it. What I would say is, I'm sure that my organization and other professional organizations are going to be digging into this as it the next several months, roll out to try to figure out what it means for communities. And I will keep you in the loop of any communications I receive about that. But I just haven't seen an analysis on this yet.
Ms. Minnick.
Ms. Duvall has her hand up if it's on the same topic, because mine was going to change.
Mine was on the same topic. It is on the same topic. My question is, coming in July, I believe, we're going to be sending out the forms for the school lunch. Will we be able to see right away then, won't we, the effect? I mean, whether some kids are going to get to eat or not, take the bus, since that's tied into it?
As I said, I don't believe this is going to impact the school lunch program, because this is another way of categorizing groups of students who you're educating. My belief at this point is that it's not a way of identifying kids who are eligible to receive free and reduced lunch.
Okay.
Essentially, in the past, the free and reduced lunch measure was being used as the measure for economic disadvantage. Now the U.S. Department of Agriculture has come up with another metric that it's asked, basically requiring states to adopt. But my understanding is that it's not basing its determinations for eligibility in the school lunch program based on the new metric.
So we could actually get two different numbers. I mean, we could have kids that are low income but not falling
into the economically disadvantaged. Right.
Okay.
Ms. Minnick.
Okay, to shift a little bit, there also is a commission, I think, or at least some kind of group touring the state, listening to concerns about PARC.
Mm-hmm.
What? What? I mean, first of all, it looks to me like for many of our districts, PARC is another unfunded mandate, simply because we don't have the technology to administer it. But that issue aside, I think that there are a lot of people that are concerned about both the curriculum that it tests and the idea of a more, possibly more comprehensive and less acceptable standardized test than the MCAS is. Mm-hmm. So what's the latest that you see?
So the most recent hearing was in Holyoke. I did not attend, but I read the coverage of it and understand that the commissioners heard many objections to the PARC. My belief is that the Board of Education is still scheduled to take its vote in October on whether we're maintaining MCAS, changing to PARC, or creating a PARC-like MCAS test. I really can't read the tea leaves on this. I don't want to venture a guess on where I think the Board of Education is going to come down, but the reason for this tour right now is to get feedback from communities. You know, right now we have approximately half of the districts in the state, like Northampton, doing MCAS, and about half of the districts doing PARC. So there is an opportunity to compare the experiences of the two districts, two types of districts, and you know, I think we just have to wait to see what the board is going to do.
Part of my reason for asking these questions is that the collaborative board, at a meeting, two meetings ago, It's morphing a little bit there. It's changing, and it's becoming more aware of some things, in particular, the collaborative's ability to have a stronger voice because it's representative of 36 districts. And if we can come up with a resolution from that, it actually, and communicate it carefully and knowledgeably to our legislators, we may have a stronger voice than we would have as just individual districts. And so they're looking at several different topics, among them unfunded mandates, park testing, foundation formula. So that was the genesis of some of my questions. But I would just say that going forward, there may be, you know, if we decide that there's something that we feel strongly about, there may be an opportunity, just as you brought to us that resolution. The collaborative director had already signed on to the Ludlow, is it Ludlow superintendent's, yeah, you know, thing. So the collaborative was kind of represented there without actually having the discussion in the board meeting. But I think that the board would like to be able to take a stand and provide some advocacy for local districts. So if there's something that you see that we should be doing, I hope you would communicate that to me.
Questions or comments? Did everyone get a chance to look at?
I'll zip my mouth, I'm sorry.
All right, seeing no further questions or comments on the superintendent's report, we're on to new business. And now we're on to future business and meeting dates. We do have a school committee meeting scheduled for August 13th, 2015 at 7:15, right back here in the JFK community room.
I also saw on August 24th is the ALT meeting, just so that we know in advance.
That is correct. That's the 24th.
Is that?
So the difference between this year and last year is the Tuesday, which is the second day, which is the date I think the committee has traditionally attended, is the same night as trans performance. So I'd like to propose is that we shift the school committee night to the first night, which would be the Monday.
I just have a question with doing that. One of the things with us having gone the second night is then ALT has already had a team, a chance to organize and present things. So how is that going to affect the actual, I mean, what we get as a committee out of the meeting?
I think that there will be no diminishment in what you get out of it. All I can do is based on what I saw last year, each of the sessions was fairly discreet, and we had committee members arriving during the Sonia Nieto presentation last year. So this year, coming on Monday, you would be attending a session that was most likely based on gearing up for goal setting for next year. So that may actually be more apropos.
Ms. Minnick?
I would say that from the time that we first had what was called summer camp, it's been anything from almost a full week of stuff to a two-day thing, and at one point in time it was any session that was going on, school committee members were welcome to attend, even if it was just people talking about how you were going to revise the civil rights training or whatever it was. I mean, to a specific thing that was targeted toward either a presentation or some kind of goal-setting work. So I mean, this is, I'm one person, but I'm authorizing you. You have carte blanche to create whatever you think works as far as a summer retreat. That, and I will say that when we've done goal setting and brainstorming things in the past, meeting with the administrative leadership team has always been very high on the list of things that the school committee likes, because we don't often get that opportunity. Those are the people that are actually implementing education in our district, and we rarely interface with them more than just in a business meeting. So we love time together, as many times as you can get them to come, that would be great with us. But and the other thing I would say is that that's a specific administrative leadership team joint thing, which I very much appreciate. But I also think, and it was brought to my attention recently by another school committee member, that we haven't done much in the way of self-assessment or any kind of training for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And I think that sort of professional development is important for us as a group as well.
Yeah. And evaluation.
You can do it in January after I'm gone.
Yes.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Okay.
I'd like to also authorize superintendent to do what he wants to do. Now we've got two authorizations, Lisa.
Okay, and with that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second. Okay, the meeting is adjourned.
All those in favor?
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
You can just say without objection.
Opposed? Now the meeting is adjourned.